Okay, so the aim of this presentation, I'm going to read and then comment a little bit on the slides and try to make this a more engaging talk. The aim of this presentation is to show that the Merleau-Ponty's phenomenological project, as it is laid out in his Phenomenology of Perception, can be located midway between Gestalt psychology and Husserlian phenomenology. So he's not a Gestalt psychologist, of course, and I will claim that neither is not a Husserlian phenomenologist. So for Merleau-Ponty, phenomenology must begin with a critique of the notion of sensation and the discovery of the notion of form, Gestalt, or shape, or configuration, before engaging in any form of phenomenological reduction. Thus, I will begin by presenting Merleau-Ponty's critique of sensation, and then I will try to give an account of why this represents for him the necessary starting point of phenomenology. So, the critique of sensation is, of course, associated with his reading of Gestalt psychologists and what he sees as the positive contribution of Gestalt psychology to the philosophy of mind. For Merleau-Ponty, the critique of sensation by Gestalt psychologists should take the place of Husserl's phenomenological reduction. So he starts precisely by this critique of sensation that in his view should replace what Husserl has presented as being a reduction, phenomenological reduction to the mind, to keep things simple. In other words, instead of putting the existence of the external world in abeyance without any mediation, Merleau-Ponty thinks that philosophy or phenomenology grows out of an immanent critique of the natural and scientific attitude. So he doesn't start immediately by putting himself, like Husserl, in the immanent realm of consciousness. He thinks that we should reach the phenomenological point of view by this immanent critique of psychologists and physiologists' conception of cognition. According to Merleau-Ponty, philosophy or phenomenology should not ignore what our best science tells us about how perception comes about. It is only by means of an eternal critique of physiology and psychology that we can gain access to the phenomenological point of view. So this contrasts strongly with the Husserlian perspective, at least in his best-known introductions to phenomenology, like Ideas 1 and Cartesian Meditations. Husserl starts by putting into question the natural and scientific attitude without any kind of internal critique of them, so without mediation. In this regard, Merleau-Ponty's procedure is more akin to that of, for example, Hegel, who also is known by his dialectical method, and by the fact that he starts with a certain position, for example, at the beginning of his Phenomenology of the Spirit or of Mind. He starts by criticizing sensation, and then from there on he passes to another point of view and so on. So I think that Merleau-Ponty's method is more, in this respect, is more akin to that of Hegel than that of Husserl. So here's a quote from Merleau-Ponty. This is why we had to begin with a study of perception through psychology. Had we not done so, we would not have understood the full sense of the transcendental problem, since we would have not followed methodically the steps that, beginning from the natural attitude, lead us there. So he doesn't leave the natural, as I said, he doesn't leave the natural attitude. He starts in the natural attitude and by its internal critique. And it is for this, for the goal of this internal critique of the natural attitude, that Merleau-Ponty sees that Gestalt psychology can be of great help. I must warn about the possible confusion that is generated by the fact that, at least in the phenomenology of perception, Merleau-Ponty tends to equate his position with that of Husserl, or at least with Husserl's last phase, that of the crisis. So Merleau-Ponty tends to present himself as a Husserlian, and that this may generate confusion in the reader, but I think that we can distinguish from Husserl's, even Husserl's last phase, which Merleau-Ponty sees as the phase where Husserl was leaving idealism behind, and Merleau-Ponty's own position. So I think that this approach may be warranted by what Merleau-Ponty sometimes says himself. Sometimes he acknowledges explicitly that, as late as the crisis, Husserl still posited the necessity of operating a second reduction between the one that leads to the lived world. The second reduction would consist in returning from the lived world, the Lebenswelt, back to the transcendental life of the ego, where the lived world itself would be constituted. So this is relevant because, as I will claim, that Merleau-Ponty's phenomenological reduction consists in this reduction to the lived world. So there's no, for Merleau-Ponty, there's no second step. And Husserl, even in the crisis, the text of the crisis, maintains this second step. So Husserl does not stay by the Lebenswelt. He then traces Lebenswelt back to the transcendental life of the ego. So I have here a quote just to sustain this position. In this, this is also from Merleau-Ponty. This is from the translation by Landes, the English translation, all this quote. In his late philosophy, Husserl acknowledged that every reflection must begin by returning to the description of the life world, Lebenswelt. But he adds that through a second reduction, the structures of the lived world, monde vécu, must themselves be put back into the transcendental flow of universal constitution, where all of the obscurities of the world would be clarified. So this is precisely it is this second, so to speak, second reduction by Husserl that Merleau-Ponty criticizes. So this was a summary. So let's start at the beginning with Merleau-Ponty's critique of sensation, and from this critique of sensation, it is from this critique of sensation that he reaches what I call his phenomenological reduction. So the reduction to the lived world. The critique of sensation opens the first chapter of the introduction to the phenomenology of perception. I will not here enter into all the details of this critique. Suffice to show that this critique is meant to lead us to the phenomenological point of view, and thus to function as a kind of surrogate for the Husserlian phenomenological reduction. So, very briefly, sensation corresponds to atomic percepts upon which all our complex perceptions would be built. Merleau-Ponty argues that the idea of an atomic percept is a mere theoretical construction, and, as he says, corresponds to nothing in our experience. If there were atomic percepts, these would be absolute terms with no relation to other percepts. They would be something so immediate that we would not be able to differentiate them from one another. So the idea is that sensation was created or invented by psychology and by philosophy before psychology, but this is a construct. So there are no sensations. We don't represent the world through sensation. The most simple percept we can think of always involves some kind of relation to others. It is never absolutely simple. So there is no simple, there is no atomic components of our perception. We can find them. We can't find them anywhere. For Merleau-Ponty, perception is never absolute coincidence with the perceived, as it would be the case if it was built out of sensations. Perception is intentional, which means that the percept displays immanent sense or meaning. It is never the case that we are confronted by pure impressions without relation to something that is perceived by means of them. So from Merleau-Ponty, much of the critique of perception has to do with the fact that we not perceive atomic percepts, but that what we perceive, what we can call sense qualities, are always endowed with meaning. So they are always related to other percepts, and this relation constitutes what he calls sense or meaning. So I don't see a pure point of white, for example. White has always qualities. Every instance of whiteness always has qualities that go beyond itself, and it is the white of each other. We must distinguish this from our visual field, which is not made of parts in the same sense that the visible objects are made of parts. If all we perceived from things was built out of sensation, then we would see only that part of the world that at each passing moment is reflected on our retina. But what we see with our eyes is always perceived to be part of something more. This has to do with a background feature of perception. So there is always an horizon, as Husserl calls it, an horizon that it is always the what exceeds what I'm immediately seeing. So I'm in this room, and I know that outside the room, the world continues, and this is part of the horizon of my present perception. So our perception is always accompanied by a background horizon in which what we are currently perceiving is located. The phenomenon of the horizon shows that one of the properties of our perceptual field is its ambiguous character. Contrary to what we know to be the case with objects, things in the perceptual field are not fully determinate. So this is a very important feature of perception from Merleau-Ponty, whereas we tend to think of perception as mirroring the properties of perceived objects. We tend to think of perception as made out of components, of sensations, and to be something like the object in the sense that is totally determinate. But from Merleau-Ponty, if we attend to what our perception is like, perceptual objects are never fully determinate. I never exhaust the possibilities of the objects. There is more, always more to see of the objects of perception than what is presently in front of me. So I have here one of the famous examples Merleau-Ponty gives. It is the Müller-Lyer lines. So you can see that the lines are of the same length, but the fact that they appear with these arrows makes the line below seem shorter than the one above. So this shows that context matters. So in perception, it is never a matter of conjoining atomic sensations to form percepts. It is always a question of the whole and the sense of the whole. Far from being a genuine ingredient of perception, sensation is a relatively recent scientific theoretical construction. It is an abstraction posited in order to explain the phenomenon of perception. So this is what I said before, that sensation is something of an invention, or a theoretical invention. There are no sensations in perception. So another quote: the classical notion of sensation was not itself a concept derived from reflection, but rather a recently developed product of thought turned toward objects. It was a final term in the representation of the world, the farthest removed from the constitutive source, and thereby the least clear. The thesis that percepts are made of sensations takes on a much broader scope when it appears in the guise of the so-called constancy hypothesis. The constancy hypothesis postulates that there is an exact correspondence between sensations and stimuli on the sense organs. So this is part of the tendency to conflate percepts with objects of perception, and to see the percepts having the structure of objects. This leads to the hypothesis that all the percepts are in a way mirror exactly the impressions we receive through our bodies. Despite its apparent scientific character, the constancy hypothesis is afflicted with hidden ontological commitments. In general, as we will see, Merleau-Ponty criticizes both science and philosophy because of its commitment to the prejudice of the world. So the constancy hypothesis and even the what I called before the experience error are part of this much broader prejudice that he calls prejudice of the world. So this is the prejudice according to which only outside objects made of parts in causal relations with each other. Most of the times, these causal relations are thought of in terms of mechanic relations between each other exist. This is the idea that the world exists in itself as a completely determinate being. In other words, the prejudice of the world is a prejudice that the world is not essentially relative to a perspective from whence it is viewed. Even intellectualist, idealist philosophies are committed to this prejudice, as we'll see. We can anticipate that Merleau-Ponty's phenomenological reduction consists in putting into question the prejudice of the world. So it is this prejudice that is not... It is not a matter of the world existing outside. It is more than that. It is the idea that the world is something totally determinate. And for Merleau-Ponty, perception is never determinate in this way. After the critique of sensation, Merleau-Ponty turns in the second chapter to the critique of the mechanism called, in the tradition, the association of ideas. And then in the third, to the theories of attention and judgment. I cannot go into detail into these critiques. Suffice to say that according to Merleau-Ponty, all these notions are meant to overcome the shortcomings of theories of perception based on the notion of sensation. So this is the Hegelian procedure that I see at play in Merleau-Ponty's approach, at least in the phenomenology of perception. The trying to explain perception through the notion of sensation leads to problems. So in order to solve these problems, philosophy creates another mechanism that is called the association of ideas to explain, to try to overcome this problem. So, but this will lead to further problems, and then theories of intention and judgment are appealed to sort out these problems. So in the end, these mechanisms end up presupposing what they are trying to explain, our most immediate and everyday perception of things endowed with sense. So in the end, Merleau-Ponty, the whole point of the Merleau-Ponty's introduction to the phenomenology of perception is to show that in the end, all these theoretical constructs to explain perception out of sensation fail. So in the case of the association of ideas, this is the mechanism that empiricists resort to in order to explain the fact that we perceive objects as wholes rather than as a sum of sensations. Through association, we would combine sensations in order to form perceptual wholes. Nonetheless, as Kant himself set out in the famous example from the first edition of the Critique of the Pure Reason, in the deduction of the categories, the theory of association presupposes what it tries to explain. Association is unable to produce the unity that is required for the perception of objects. So when I appeal to association, when I resort to association to explain my perception, I always presuppose what I have at the beginning. This is an object, this chair, this table, objects endowed with sense. This is what I immediately have in perception. and what theorists like David Hume explain through the association of ideas is already presupposed at the beginning. It is only because we already perceive meaningful roles, everyday objects, that you can start looking for what makes its parts belong together. For example, for contiguity and resemblance between among them. So now to the I'll pass to the projection of memories, and the same objection applies to this mechanism. Memory is only able to contribute to perception because we recognize the immanent sense of the percept in the first place. Otherwise, our mind would not know what memories should be evoked. Merleau-Ponty doesn't deny that memory plays a role in perception. Memory is an ingredient of present perception in the guise of Husserl's primary memory or retention. The immediate past functions as an implicit horizon of perception. It is only because of this that it is always possible for us to turn our attention towards the past and reopen it, as Merleau-Ponty says. So, even in the case of the projection of memories, when I appeal to memory to somehow complete my present perception, I always presuppose what I had at the beginning. And this doesn't mean that he denies the role of memory, but memory is for him what it is for Husserl, an implicit horizon, something that I not. There is memory that I can evoke, past memory, but there is this retention memory that it is the corresponds to the immediate past, that it is always somehow. Contained in the present perception. After having considered the association of ideas and projection of memories, what time do I have?
You've got another 20 minutes.
Okay, that's fine. After having considered the association of ideas and the projection of memories, Merleau-Ponty turns in the third chapter of the introduction to the phenomena of attention and judgment. At this point, intellectualist theories of perception become the focus of his critique. So, hitherto, his main focus of critique had been empiricist theories. Now he turns to intellectualist theories. But the problem is the same. They try to explain perception starting from certain presuppositions about the world. And about how perception is shaped in a way that mirrors how worldly objects are shaped. So intellectualist theories lead to a view of the object of perception as constructed by the mind and its operations. At bottom, intellectualist theories of perception are confronted with the same problem as empiricist ones: how to account for the emergence of sense in perception. How is it that sensations can be conjoined to form meaningful wholes? Intellectualism accounts for the fact that we immediately perceive things endowed with sense by arguing that it was the mind that put sense or meaning in them in the first place. Meaningful wholes, Gestalten, would be the product of our intellect. So, in a way, intellectualism acknowledges the failure of empiricism in that it sees the impossibility of accounting for perception in a way that makes perception made of atomic percepts, but it goes one step further and tries to say that the sense that is contained in my perception, in my perceptual object, is itself made or constructed by the mind, or it is somehow put there by the mind. I will not pursue much further the details of this critique. Rather, I want to draw attention to the fact that Merleau-Ponty sees intellectualist theories of perception as ensuing from an internal critique of empiricist theories. And so, in a way, intellectualism has the same presuppositions as empiricism. Intellectualism is supposed to provide a better solution to the problem that gave rise to empiricist theories. Nonetheless, in the end, intellectualist theories of perception share the same hidden ontology, the prejudice of the world, as the empiricist theories. So this is another quote. By throwing me toward the world of things, the natural attitude assures me of grasping a real beyond appearances and the true beyond illusions. Intellectualism does not question the value of these notions. It merely confers upon universal creativity the power of recognizing the very same absolute truth that realism naively locates in a given nature. So, intellectualism and empiricism share the same prejudice. The world exists in a totally determinate manner, whether the latter is conceived as the product of our mind or as existing in itself outside. So this is very important, because the problem with the so-called prejudice of the world, it is not that the what the idealist would, what someone, for example, like Husserl, would criticize on empiricism, that the world, that empiricism presupposes the world existing outside in itself. The intellectualist, by presupposing that the mind somehow creates the world or synthesizes sensations in a way that sense comes from the mind, shares a similar prejudice. Is that they all, both of them take the world to be something totally determinate, something that exists in itself beyond points of view. Something that it is what it is, independent of if it is in the mind or outside of the mind. So intellectualism, as well as empiricism, rely on what Merleau-Ponty calls in the Phenomenology of Perception the originary doxa of perception. This doxa consists in the privilege of the object at the expense of perception. Not only the constitutive role of perception tends to be forgotten, but also the essentially perspective character of the world itself. This forgetfulness is a tendency of perception itself, which effaces itself in face of its object. What both empiricism and intellectualism tend to forget is precisely this perspective character, or perspectivistic, I don't know, character of the world and of things in the world. They tend to think of the world as a world seen from nowhere. This kind of attitude is present right from the beginning in perception itself. It is perception by effacing itself and leading us somehow into the object, into its object, that make us forget this perspective character, its own perspective character. The problem with both intellectualism and empiricism is not the fact that they make use of the originary doxa, but rather the fact that this doxa is not made into an object of inquiry, and thus is able to operate in an inconspicuous manner. So, Merleau-Ponty, much of Merleau-Ponty's phenomenological project has to do with this returning to perception as our original opening to the world from our point of view. And it is this feature that all theories of perception, even the ones that seem most opposite, tend to forget. As I have shown, intellectualism ensues from empiricism's failure to account for perception based on the notion of sensation and the constancy hypothesis. By questioning the status and role of sensation in perception and by relinquishing the constancy hypothesis, Gestalt psychology may give rise to another kind of philosophy. Merleau-Ponty says that the critique of the constancy hypothesis, when carried to its conclusion, takes on the value, this is Merleau-Ponty's quote, a quote from Merleau-Ponty, takes on the value of a true phenomenological reduction. So Gestalt psychologists have not thought about that, have not seen themselves as carrying phenomenological reduction, but he sees that the positive value of Gestalt psychology is precisely the fact that they criticized and rejected the notion of sensation and the constancy hypothesis. However, Gestalt psychologists never really abandoned the naturalistic standpoint and the ideal of knowledge that goes with it. They in a way, maintain the prejudice of the world. They believe that perceptive phenomena can be explained in natural scientific fashion through an investigation of their causes. They still endorse a naturalistic, realist point of view. Whereas Merleau-Ponty, although not an idealist in the sense of intellectualist philosophy, thinks that the world is crucially dependent upon, or at least intertwined with, the body subject. So Merleau-Ponty is not an idealist in the sense that intellectualists are idealists, but he too thinks that the world is crucially dependent upon us, but not us as subjects or mind, as transcendental subjects or minds, but us understood as bodies, or as he also says, body subjects. Although Gestalt psychologists never fulfilled the potential of their critique of traditional approaches to perception, phenomenology should take this critique as its starting point. The questioning of the prejudice of the world entails a reduction to what Merleau-Ponty calls the phenomenal field. Merleau-Ponty also calls the phenomenal field by the name world of perception or lived world. The latter is in fact the French translation of Husserl's Lebenswelt. So, to return to what I was saying at the beginning, Merleau-Ponty's phenomenological reduction consists precisely in this return to the phenomenal field, putting aside all presuppositions about the nature of perception that make perception mirror the way outside objects are. What I've been calling Merleau-Ponty's phenomenological reduction consists then in the return from the objective world to the lived world of perception. Both the natural and the scientific attitude tend to posit things as existing in themselves and as the ultimate reason or cause of our perception. In this sense, Merleau-Ponty's reduction opposes the natural tendency found within perception itself of objectifying its phenomena. So this is another quote. I think that I will skip it because otherwise I will not reach the end. Phenomena are not subjective constructs or figments of my mind. This is very important for him. This return to the phenomenal field or to phenomena does not mean that we are returning to an inner world of introspection. Phenomena exist outside as phenomena. In fact, Merleau-Ponty's reduction does not in any way entails putting into question the outside world, as Rousseau, for example, sometimes appears to do. The phenomenal world is just that, this is I took it from Heidegger, but I think that it can apply as well to Merleau-Ponty's project. The phenomenal world is just that which shows itself in the very way in which it shows itself from itself. Phenomena are the forms, the gestalten, that is the spontaneous sense with which things are naturally endowed for us. So this is the starting point. This is the place where we should start without presuppositions and misconceptions. So this is another quote. I will skip the quote. According to Merleau-Ponty, the experience of phenomena involves the return to the pre-objective, pre-scientific life of consciousness. It is very important to distinguish the return to the phenomenal field from the Husserlian phenomenological reduction. For Merleau-Ponty, the return to the phenomenal field does not in any way mean that phenomena should be considered as mind-dependent. He discovers phenomena to be intertwined with us in important ways, but with us understood as body subjects. This is the reason why Merleau-Ponty insists so much in the anti-intellectualist status of his phenomenology. So I maintain that the sort of reduction he's trying to accomplish is different from the Husserlian one. What does the return to phenomena entail then? According to my interpretation, what is at stake is to put in abeyance not the mind of objects, but rather the prejudice of the world. As I said, the prejudice of the world means, for Merleau-Ponty, the prejudice that things are a sum of parts, that they are totally determined, independent of any perspective, that their relation to each other is exclusively causal, and that our body is just one more thing among things. When this is, of course, will be the subject of the first section of the phenomenology of perception, is precisely the body. And how the science, the critique of the scientific views of the body as a more an object among objects, when the body is not, or at least the body as a lived body, is our means of access to the world. So it can never be reduced to an object among objects in the world. The prejudice of the world ends up in the prejudice concerning the status of our own body and its relations to the world. To suspend the prejudice of the world implies ceasing to take our body as one object more among objects. Ultimately, the suspension of the prejudice of the world consists in accepting the primacy of what immediately shows itself in face of all theoretical constructions that try to explain away phenomena. Because of this, I think that Gestalt psychology had the merit of restoring epistemic primacy to phenomena. The anti-intellectualist and anti-idealist stance of Merleau-Ponty's return to phenomena implies that the phenomenal field cannot become a transcendental field. So he uses these technical terms in order to distinguish his own field of investigation from Husserl's field of investigation. Forms, Gestalten, as perceptual phenomena are not traced back to the constituting power of the transcendental ego. He opposes to Husserl's phenomenological reduction the idea that the phenomenal field is opaque. This means that the phenomenal field can never be put before us in full transparency, which would mean to be able to make perception totally intelligible. So one of his main tenets throughout the phenomenology of perception is the idea that we can never fully account for our perception, whereas an intellectualist stance like the one from Husserl argues that we can somehow through reflection account for our perception, for the way, for example, this chair appears to me endowed with certain properties. He says that Merleau-Ponty defends that we can never fully account for this perceptual life. Because exactly because we are body subjects, so in a sense we can never reflection can never fully recover the pre-reflective life of the body. So perceptual sense cannot be shown to be the product of a free-floating transcendental subject, in which case reality would be necessarily be rational, since everything would display the trace of the transcendental subject's activity. In contrast to this, Merleau-Ponty holds that the sense is contingent. We cannot presuppose that events have a rational course and everything a priori has sense. So his anti-intellectualist sense also means that we cannot presuppose, for example, that history has a rational course, or that everything that exists in some way necessarily has meaning or a reason behind it. What Merleau-Ponty opposes to Husserl is the impossibility of a reflection that would apprehend the irreflective life of our consciousness body. I hesitate between calling this phenomenon consciousness because I believe that Merleau-Ponty locates in the lived body what Sartre has called pre-reflective consciousness and named it the tacit cogito. This is the chapter on the cogito, Merleau-Ponty's chapter on the cogito. I believe that this tacit cogito is the same as our lived body, and it is what Sartre called the pre-reflective consciousness, that is consciousness has reflexivity of its own. So it is somehow reflected upon itself, but in such a way that reflexivity is implicit in it. We don't need to turn towards our consciousness to reflect. We are at bottom, consciousness is at bottom reflective, or better, pre-reflective. So, according to Merleau-Ponty, Husserl's procedure would entail making explicit everything that is involved in the constitution of the world. If the world is constituted by means of the body, and if this body is a pre-personal consciousness, it is in principle impossible for reflection to account for everything that is involved in the way my body opens itself to the world. And I think this is my last slide. Yeah. This thesis is also entailed by what we may call Merleau-Ponty's perspectivism. A complete reduction to the transcendental ego would imply that the latter would be a kind of absolute consciousness that would let everything appear in a totally transparent manner. If we are body subjects, we are necessarily involved in a certain perspective. We are points of view on and off the world, as Merleau-Ponty will say later in the visible and the invisible. Reflection cannot efface the perspectival character of our consciousness body. In fact, reflective consciousness lives off and depends upon our pre-reflective perspective and not the other way around. As Merleau-Ponty himself says from the preface, reflection is always reflection upon an unreflected. So, thank you.